O give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. O give thanks to the God of gods, for his mercy endures forever. O give thanks to the Lord, for his mercy endures forever. To whom, to him alone, does great wonders, for his mercy endures forever. Somebody give God praise for his great wonders. He's a wonder-working God. Amen, somebody. He works wonders. He works wonders for all of us, and we are just delighted. To all of our guests, we thank you for being with us today, and we appreciate your presence. All of you who are with us online, we thank you for joining us, and we're going to get in the Word in just a moment. And if you would, please go ahead and turn your Bibles. To Matthew's Gospel, chapter 6. Today begins a new day and a new week. We thank God for Resurrection Sunday. Didn't we celebrate on Resurrection Sunday? And all of you who journeyed out to be with us, we thank you. Don't let me, when you came last week, you got CME Christians. Y'all know what CME Christians mean? Christmas, Mother's Day, Easter. Yeah, let's put some in between that, okay? Let's put some attendance in between that. One of the things we practiced during Lent was those five spiritual disciplines, and we talked about those and we prayed over those. And one of them was us getting together. How important it is for Christians to assemble themselves together, so that we can touch and agree and be what God wants us to be. Amen? So thank you for making sure that you were here with us. Let's do it. Everybody, speak to my heart, Holy Spirit. Today, I start a new sermon series that I talked to y'all about last Sunday. What is it called? Now, I don't want all the saved and just sanctified, and you've been saved for a long time. Don't let me lose you. Y'all still saved. All right? I still love the Lord. I'll talk to this side. All y'all been saved for a long time. I still love the Lord. From Soul Town to Motown, or Motown to Soul Town. Spin that, BJ.
Hey, mama, I got my shaking room on the floor. Everybody's got a pain, but some don't know how to handle it. Always reaching out in vain.
Let me get to the part that y'all all know.
Just thinking that things not worth having.
Don't you worry about a thing. Come on. Don't you worry about a thing, mama.
Where y'all
at? What's wrong with y'all? Y'all shame because y'all in the church, ain't you? Oh, I got mixed emotions right now, Pastor. Y'all didn't have mixed emotions last night. Huh? They don't know the song. They know the song, though. At least I got some people over here saying, I know the song, and I'm going to sing it. Okay, I'm going to give y'all one more chance. Robin, roll it back to 35, and we're going to try it one more time. Robin, all right, I'm going to give y'all one more chance. Y'all don't act like this next week because I got a good one next week. All right, here we go, Robin.
Hey, mama, because I got my shaking room on the floor. Everybody's got a thing, but
soon don't
know.
Play it like you was in the club. Turn it up.
Always reaching out in vain, just taking the things not worth having. But don't you worry about a thing.
There you go.
Don't you worry about a thing, mama. 'Cause I'll be standing on the side when you check it out.
Don't you worry about a thing.
Say your style of life's a drag, and that you must go. Don't you worry about a thing. Don't you worry about a thing, mama.
Why?
'Cause I'll be standing on the side when you check it out. When you get off your trip.
All right, that's good. I was about to get to the good part. I didn't want y'all to forget where y'all was that time, because the good part is coming up. Amen? We're starting this, and it's going to be reminders from the 60s, the 70s, and the 80s of R&B and some 90s about soul, about things that affect our soul. Issues that affect our souls. Amen, somebody? We still saved. Tell your neighbors, hey, we still saved. I know some of y'all tripping. Lord, have mercy. Y'all, I know y'all praying and speaking in tongues. Forgive him, Lord. Forgive him. Forgive him. We still saved. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 6. And this morning, I'm going to read it from the New Living Translation, beginning at verse 25. This is why I tell you not to worry about everyday life, whether you have enough food or drink or enough clothes to wear. Isn't life more than food? And your body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They don't plant or harvest or store food in barns, for your heavenly Father feeds them. And aren't you more valuable to him than they are? Can all your worries add a single moment to your life? And why worry about your clothing? Look at the lilies of the field and how they grow. They don't work or make their clothing, yet Solomon, in all of his glory, was not dressed as beautifully as they are. And if God cares so wonderfully for wildflowers that are here today and thrown into the fire tomorrow, he will certainly care for you. Why do you have so little faith? So don't worry, don't worry, don't worry about these things, saying, what will we eat? What will we drink? What will we wear? These things dominate the thoughts of unbelievers. Let me read that again. Verse 32, these things dominate the thoughts of unbelievers, but your heavenly Father already knows all your needs. Seek the kingdom of God above all else and live righteously, and he will give you everything you need. So don't worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will bring its own worries. Today's trouble is enough for today. Somebody shout amen. I had a friend that said, just let the word preach to you. Title of the sermon this morning is Don't Worry. You may have your seats. Father, we give you thanks and praise. We give you glory for all that you do on a consistent basis. We thank you, Father, that you've allowed us to be here today. You didn't have to do it, but we're so glad you did. You saw fit to bring us to this week. Father, over the obstacles and over the trials that we went through this last week, you are still good. And your mercy endures forever. And we give you thanks and praise. Bless us now that our hearts may be ready to receive the word. Bless our minds that we can stay focused. And Father, bless our spirits that it may sink, the word may sink in and give a harvest. 30-fold, 60-fold, and 100-fold, in the name of Jesus. Let everybody say amen. We all experience stress, worry, anxiety at some level. Every last one of us. Some stress is natural. Some stress is not natural. But stress for the believer should be transient. It should not be long lasting. Should not last forever. It should come to an end. There is good stress and there is toxic and unhealthy stress. Nearly 3 out of 4, one source says, of Americans felt that 2020 was the most stressful year of their lives. 57% of Americans said, I've never experienced a kind of stress that I experienced during the pandemic. Stress, brothers and sisters, and worry, it is a part of life, but that does not mean that we should wear it all the time. The world gives us many reasons to be anxious and worried. Stories of war, stories of natural disaster, stories of the pandemic, broken relationships, financial insecurities and instabilities, health concerns, all give us or is a part or a source of stress and worry. We have to meet deadlines. We have to pay mortgages and student loans, kids in school, our social and economic standing within the community. We stress over stuff that we should not be stressed over. What is stress? Stress is a state of mental or emotional strain or tension resulting from the adverse and very demanding, sometimes unpredictable circumstances. The state of worry and our mental instability at times, and I did say all of us at some point have some mental instability. Especially when the stresses are so intense, we make irrational decisions. I always tell you, do not make decisions that have while you are stressed or while you are emotional. Inevitably, they will lead you to a ram and to a sphere that you never wanted to be in. Stress affects not only the body, but it affects your mind and it affects your spirit. When I was in pharmacy, the highest prescribed medication was Zantac. Do y'all know what Zantac is? It's for that anxiety, well, that feeling of reflux that stress brings about at times. Stress causes anxiety and irritability. Why are you so irritable? Because I'm stressed out. Why y'all so quiet? Hard to concentrate. Why? Because I'm stressed out. Gives us headaches, body aches, upset stomach, high blood pressure. Can't sleep at night. Can't sleep during the day. All kinds of things are going wrong with our bodies because of stress. Black folk in particular, we are stressed to the hilt because we see such injustices in our communities. We're stressed when our children get home because they're stressing us out. We're stressed when they leave home because we're worried about if they will return home. Amen, somebody. We're stressed. We're stressed because even as black folk drive down the street, we get stressed out because we don't know the unpredictable behaviors of those who bit from the apple that we talked about. Well, it wasn't an apple, it was a fruit, but he bit from the apple of hatred and injustice. Stress. Job layoffs. School exams. Lord have mercy. Unrealistic workloads. Unrealistic expectations. Conflict with the family. Lord have mercy. Unanticipated events that affect us so dramatically, like deaths and divorce and child killings, cause all of us, even if it's not your child, we have worry and distress over it. Let's look at the text for a moment. Stress, as I said, affects all of us. Let me give you a couple of more statistics for a moment. Mississippi is the most stressed out state in the union. Louisiana, don't say where you're from, just is the second most stressed out state in the union. Younger people have the highest stress related to the pressures in this life. 60% of 18 to 24 year olds and 41% of 25 to 34 year olds cite that their stress is through the roof. They don't know what to do. They don't know what the expectations are. They don't know, or they are uncertain about their own future. They are stressed out. 17% of 45 to 54 year olds say they experience stress, but at a much lesser degree. Deacon Rose, 6% of the 55 and older year olds say nothing don't bother me no more. There's some stuff you just learn as you get older. I am who I am. Dr. Gray said, that's right. We don't care whether you like us or not. We're not looking for likes. As long, I understand it now. I didn't understand it when my mom and my daddy would say, as long as I wake up, everything else gonna be all right. If I can move my arms and my legs, I can make everything else work. If you give me a reasonable portion of health and strength and in my right mind, I can make everything else work. As we get older, we like, I don't care. Y'all, you don't pay my bills. I'll worry about it if you're paying my bills, but if you ain't paying them, I ain't worried. Jesus is giving his Sermon on the Mount, and he's giving us practical applications for spiritual living, for pleasing the Father. He talks in this long discourse from about chapter 5 all the way through verse chapter 7 about how we can apply the commandments and how we can live them out daily so that we can be pleasing to God. Jesus' Sermon on the Mount is caught up in chapter 6, where we just read from him telling people as they gathered and listened to him, here is what the Ten Commandments and what God and who God is. And brothers and sisters, as we sit here this morning and we contemplate right now what I'm stressed about, what I'm going to do about it, I've learned that if you can't do nothing about it, ain't no sense in worrying about it. There's just some stuff you ain't going to be able to do anything about. Amen, somebody. There's just some stuff that's going to come that there's nothing that you can do about it. But the scriptures remind us, and let me read this one for you. In Philippians, he tells us, gives us an idea and a clue about what God expects when we are stressed out. Let me just put y'all in some good company because I know y'all think I'm coming down on you. You ain't the only Christians and the only people who believed in God that was ever stressed out. God's anointed Joseph. Joseph was blamed for and punished for something that he did not do. And Joseph got stressed out because he told one of the people, when you get back to the king, tell him what has happened. And the man just goes on about his business. You don't think that caused Joseph some stress? All right, since y'all didn't go with that one, maybe Daniel will help y'all. Been put in the lion's den for doing what God told him to do. Y'all missed that. Sometimes doing what God tells you to do will cause you some temporary stress. Y'all ain't with that one. Let me see if David will help you. David had family issues, marriage problems, children issues, somebody who wanted to kill him, Saul issues. You don't think David was stressed at times? If that one don't help you, Elijah had stress problems. Remember when he had gone and killed the prophets of Baal, and the queen says, I'm going to get you. And he runs off and says, Lord, what is going on? Is there nobody left but me, stressed out? Y'all ain't with that. Moses, who got the Ten Commandments and went up on the mountain and just was there with God, came back down with the tablets in his hand. The Bible tells me he was so angry and stressed that he just threw them on the ground. Brother was stressed out. Why do these people won't act right? Why won't they do what's right? I ask myself that sometimes. Why won't they just do what's right? People get stressed out. Y'all don't like that. Let me just remind you one more. Last week we read about Jesus over in the Garden of Gethsemane, praying so hard that his sweat, his vessels, began to rupture and was filled with blood. You don't think that's a stressful situation? Even Jesus experienced some temporary stress. Y'all ain't with me. You and I will experience some temporary stress. What can we do? Look at chapter 4 of Philippians. It tells us, it gives us some insight. In verse 4, rejoice in the Lord when? When you're stressed? When you're frustrated? Always keep on doing what? Why y'all so quiet? Y'all finding it hard to rejoice when you're stressed out? Thank you for being honest. We find it hard sometimes to be rejoiceful before God when we're stressed out, bills are due, things are happening, and we're asking God, what is going on? And we need to tell God, I'm stressed. I got all this mess that's going on, and I need some help. But the first key is you got to learn to rejoice. Touch your neighbor and say, I got to learn to rejoice. And he says, and again, rejoice. Let your gentleness, not your anger, be known to all men, even when you're frustrated, that the Lord is at hand. Here it is. It gets better. Verse 4. Don't worry. Don't be anxious for what? What y'all anxious about? Ask yourself. You know what you're anxious about. You know what's frustrating you. You know what makes you mad. You know what's getting on your last good nerve. Be anxious for nothing. If you don't name it, you can't deal with it. I'll talk to the other side. If you don't name it, you don't know what it is, you want to identify it, you can't deal with it. You better learn how to name and deal with your issues. Lord have mercy. I know that. I wish I was. Because some of us don't want to talk about, don't want to think through what we're going through. Because we feel vulnerable and it may make me look bad. And you won't name it and won't go get no help. Because why? Be anxious for nothing. Tell your neighbor, say, be anxious for nothing. I'm teaching better than y'all are acting this morning. Be anxious for nothing. Be anxious and worried over nothing. Didn't Jesus just tell us on the Sermon on the Mount, stop worrying about all this stuff? I want you to do something mentally real quick with me. Look at your, don't do it right now, but just think about it. Look at your credit card statement. Look at your bank account statement. That will tell you a lot about what you stressed over. If you just look at some of the dynamics that's going on in your life, it will tell you, especially financially, what you are stressed out about. Just do self-examination and then name it. And then you can tell the Lord, this demon got to go. We spend too much time playing patty cake. With the enemy. Y'all ain't talking to me over there. I'll talk to you. You spend too much time playing patty cake with the enemy. And when he turns the patty caking situation up on the heat, then you're mad. Be anxious for nothing. That's the first thing. Be anxious for nothing. Number one, that's number two. Number one is rejoice. Learn to rejoice. God inhabits the praises of his people. Learn to rejoice in your situation, no matter what's going on. Paul says, I've learned to be content that no matter what state I find myself in, whether I have a lot or whether I have a little, I've learned to be content. Noble, every time I go to the mall, I walk in, I see all kind of stuff. And it seemed like it's just calling my name. That's just me and nobody else. Thank you, John. It just seems like it knows my name. It is just calling me. You need this. You will look finer in this. You're going to look good in this. You need this. And you buy stuff that you don't need, running up more credit card bills. We got stuff in our closet right now. Can somebody talk to me? We got stuff in our closet right now. We ain't wore, still got the tags on it. Because we got caught up in an emotional feeling on the state of purchase, and then 30 days later, y'all ain't with me, we regretting what we got. Lord have mercy. And Jesus just told us, stop worrying about all that stuff what you gonna wear. Stop worrying about what you gonna wear. Stop worrying about superficial material things, because it ain't gonna do nothing but drive you crazy. Y'all ain't with me. I'm trying to help you. Because some of us are in so much debt. Do they still say they're trying to keep up with the... Oh, I guess they do. Do y'all know who they are? I've been looking for the Joneses. Do y'all know? When you find them, will you tell them I'm looking for them? We're always trying to keep up with other folk, impress other people, trying to stay on par. When scripture tells us, don't live like that. You're just going to add more stress to your life. Amen, somebody. I'm about to go off on a tangent. No, y'all ain't gonna like it. You ain't gonna like it. This country, this world in which we live, I have told them, John Ellis, I've told all of us, make sure you keep some money stashed away The old people used to say, put it somewhere, bury it in your yard, whatever, keep some. But not only is it getting bad in terms of, you know, if the grid goes down and you can't access your credit card, your debit card, make sure you have some cash. Make sure you got some money, honey. Something you can put your own hands on. Y'all with me? If the grid goes down, what you gonna do? Second thing about that, as I go off on this tangent, not only should you have some money, make sure you have as low a debt as you possibly can. Y'all look at the economics of this country and look at what's going on. One of the things I was reading is that debt adds more stress than anything. Y'all, we need to get out of debt. Pay yourself first. Well, pay God. Pay the Lord first. But get out of debt. Alleviate that stress. It's coming back around every 30 days. We don't need the phone ringing all the time. Looking for, you know, it got so bad for somebody, they called the church. Do you know this person? I said, man, there's some 600 people in our church. Well, they listed you, this church, as one of their people that you could be contacted if they have some problems. I said, I don't know. I'm sorry. I was like Peter and Jesus. I don't know him. Number one, learn to rejoice. Number two, decrease your anxiety level by letting stuff go. Oh, I hear you, Holy Spirit. I hear you. I got to tell y'all this, Holy Spirit just dropped. Let folk go. Stop being stressed out over people. It's interrupting the flow between you and God. Yeah, don't let people keep getting on your nerves. Because they'll find them. I'll talk to this side. You know people will find that nerve. Y'all ain't never had nobody find that nerve. They'll search you, you know, they'll talk to you and find out what gets on your nerves, and then they'll just play with your nerves. And then we have to ask for forgiveness after we cut them. Y'all ain't never, because they got on our nerves. Y'all ain't never told nobody, don't play with me, don't play with me, don't play with me. As your mama said, I ain't nothing to play with, baby. I ain't nothing to play with. Stop getting anxious and stressed out over money and people. Here's the instructions. Rejoice. Stop being anxious. Pray about it. Y'all see it? It's right there. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by what? And take it to the Lord in prayer. That's what he tells us to do, isn't it? It says, don't worry about it. Bring it to me. Y'all see? It's clear. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication. Pray about it. Tell somebody, say, I gotta pray about it. I gotta pray about it. I'm gonna pray for these people. Amen, somebody. I'm pray for them because they work at my nerves. I gotta pray for them. Because if I don't pray for them, it looks like I'm gonna hurt them. Pray about it. Pray about it, let it go. You hear me? Pray about it, let it go. Let that ring in your spirit. Pray about it, let it go. Don't clap back. Don't bust a cap. Pray about it. Let it go. I'm going to tell you about that one in just a moment. Pray about it. Let it go. Verse 6, it says, be anxious for nothing. Stop being anxious. Stop being worried. Stop being stressed out. Stevie tells us, and y'all know, I love Stevie. He's my all-time favorite singer and lyric writer. His relationship with God comes through in his songs. And I believe he was writing not only to the secular world, but we can certainly benefit from be anxious for nothing. Don't you worry about a thing. Don't you worry about a thing, mama. Don't worry about it. Let it go. Cast it on the Lord. Let him deal with it. Because if you know you can't handle it. If you could, you would. Amen, somebody. And I probably need to define that word. Some stuff y'all handle that you know you shouldn't handle. Because you get wrapped up in yourself and say, I'm going to fix it. Because the Lord blessed me with hands. Because if he don't help me, I'm about to lay my hands. And I ain't going to be praying. Prayer, supplication. You see it? And then he tells us something quite inquisitive about how to get through our stress. He says, change your focus. Lord have mercy. Do y'all see it in the text? He says, don't be anxious for nothing. Stop being anxious about all this stuff that Jesus told us about clothing, about what you're going to wear and what you're going to drink and what you're going to eat and who you're going to dine with. Stop worrying about all that stuff. He says, don't be anxious about it, but in everything by prayer and supplication. Then he takes us deeper. He says, now here's how to stay focused. Here's how to take your eyes and your mind off your problem. Oh, it's good. It's good. He says, here's what you need to do to really get through this thing. He says, start giving thanks to God. I'm almost finished. He says, your focus is on your worries and your problems, but if you start thinking about the goodness of God, he said, I believe it'll lift your spirits. We won't live in depression. We won't live where we're all sad. He says, start just thinking about God. He says, with prayer and supplication and thanksgiving, we start to tell somebody, I just need to thank God for what he gave me. Amen, somebody. I just need to thank God for what he has given me. Amen. When you start thinking about the goodness of God and what he has given you and how he has taken care of you, you stop thinking about the problems and you start thinking about how good God is. Y'all understand now. You see why old folks start having less problems? Because they say, Lord, you woke me up this morning. Started me on my way. Put food on my table. They didn't have everything. Amen, somebody. They didn't have all time steak. They didn't have all the time of the shrimp and lobster. But they were just thankful for the chitlins and the pig feet and the pig ears and just a little bit of rice and green beans and collard greens. They were just thankful for the little bit they had. I thought I felt almost like Shirley Caesar was coming up in me. She said, greens, beans, tomatoes, and mayo. Yeah, we need to understand, just be thankful for what you have and watch God begin to work even more. If you just get thankful for this old raggedy bucket that I have to drive every day, I thank God that I can put a little gas in it. I thank God that he's able to provide for me if I just start thanking him. Yeah. It ain't the job that I want, it ain't the job that I deserve, but thank God I'm here right now, and this the job I got, because if I just thank him, he gonna bless me with more. If I just praise him, he gonna give me a little bit more. If I just rejoice in the Lord, he gonna give me a little bit more. So while I'm in the state that I'm in, I can be content. Why? Because the Lord shall supply all of my needs. I'm through according to his riches and glory. Tell your neighbor, say, he gonna supply. He will supply. He will supply. Yeah. 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 I feel a little bit better. I feel a little bit better, folks. I'm trying to take my seat. But I remember when sometimes I didn't have the money. Sister Stacy and I just had to depend on the Lord. Oh, Lord, he brought me from a long way. We couldn't go out to eat all like we do now. But we kept on praying, kept on believing that the Lord would make it better if we just hang on in there. And say, by faith, I'm going to have more one day. The Lord is good. He sees my tomorrow. You got to look at your tomorrow and say, it's going to be better than it is today. But while I'm in today, I'm going to bless his name. I'm going to glorify his name. I'm going to tell him he's a good God. I ain't going to wait till I get dressed up. I can praise him in raggedy clothes and raggedy shoes. So when I really get it, what he want me to have, y'all won't look at me crazy and say, well, he just started dancing since he got new clothes. No, baby, I've been dancing all along because I knew the Lord would bring me out. I knew the Lord would make a way. I knew the Lord wasn't going to let me stay down. I knew the Lord would lift me up. I knew the Lord would help me if I just stayed faithful to him. I knew the Lord in his word if I just trusted that everything was going to be all right. Just like he got up last Sunday, he gets up every Sunday. And we ought to learn to bless his name. Somebody shout, yeah. Somebody shout, yeah. Somebody say, yes, he will. Say, yes, he will. Said he did it before. And he'll do it again. Bless the Lord at all times. Let his praise continually be in your hearts. Stand to your feet. Let's go home. Yes, he will make a way. Yesterday, I was after the men's meeting. Yesterday, after the men's meeting, I was outside walking around and DJ. I was walking around and I was looking at the yard. And I was looking and I was thinking about the sermon a little bit. And all of a sudden, on the sidewalk, shows up a sparrow. I said, thank you, Jesus. Some of y'all missed that. His eye is on the sparrow. I said, his eye is on the sparrow. I said, little sparrow, you look good hopping. I talked to him, but he was ignoring me. I said, but you helped me make my sermon clearer. That if God, you watch, I said this, God, if you're watching him, I know you're watching me. I know if you're watching that sparrow, I know you're watching me. Because the word just told us that he looks at the sparrow And aren't you more important than a sparrow? So I know he's watching us. When you keep reading that text, he says, he knows the hairs are all numbered on your head. God knows what you're going through, and he knows how to deliver you. Somebody stretch your hand and say, my deliverance on the way. Somebody came to me last week and said, Pastor, I'm in my 3 days. Somebody said, I'm in my 3 days. Three days. It may take 3 weeks, but it's okay. I'm in my 3 days. Amen, somebody. If his eyes are watching the sparrow, I know he watches me. Stevie got it right, y'all. Stevie got it right. Don't you worry about a thing. Tell your neighbor, say, don't you worry about a thing. Don't you worry. Lord have mercy. Don't worry about a thing. Don't you worry about a thing. I don't care what the doctor say. Don't worry. Don't worry. I don't care what the banker said. Don't worry. I don't care what people around you say. Don't worry. Don't you worry about a thing. Give it to God. Let me quote you one scripture. Psalms 55 verse 22 says, cast your burdens, your cares. First Peter says, cast your cares on him. Y'all got to learn how to get rid of stuff. Amen, somebody? So tell somebody, say, I'm going to get rid of it. I'm going to get rid of it. Keep looking straight ahead. Keep looking straight ahead. Because you don't want nobody to think, I'm getting rid of you. We need to know, cast your cares on him. Stretch your head and say, God, I'm casting my cares on you. Come on, tell him, start praying. I'm casting these cares. I'm casting these worries on you. I'm casting my burdens on you. I'm going to live in a space and a place where I can have peace. Come on, keep praying. John chapter 14, 27 says, peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Peace. Father, I thank you today that you have talked to your people. And I pray, Father, that they would receive your peace, that they would learn the mystery of how to get through stressful situations. Father, that they would learn, God, that if they learn to rejoice, and they would learn how to be thankful in every situation, God, you help them to get over their stress. Help them to cast their cares on you, Father. Let somebody leave freer today than what they did when they walked in. Bless them, God. Bless them right now. Father, relieve burdens right now. Father, relieve burdens. We rebuke burdens in the name of Jesus. We rebuke demons and principality who try to burden your people down so much that they don't know whether they're going or coming. I pray, Father, that you just bless them, relieve the internal anxieties and the worries, oh God. Do some heart surgery right now, Father, to remove those things that are burdening their hearts. Do some mind examination, Father, on them so they can get rid of all the worries and the cares. Father, I know you care for us. Your word tells us you care for us. You would never leave us, nor would you ever forsake us. So God, help us to don't live in the space of worry, but help us to live in the space of peace. In the name of Jesus. Thank you for these wonderful people. God, bless them now as they get ready to leave and go have a great week. Father, watch over them. Let the word come back to them, Lord, how to deal with that when stressful situations arise, how to deal with it. In the name of Jesus. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Three questions. Question number one is about salvation. Salvation. If you don't know who Jesus is and you have never confessed him as your Lord and Savior, you need to now say, God, I want you to come into my heart because I'm in this space where I got so much stress and I really don't know how to deal with it. Question number one is about giving your life to Jesus so you can experience salvation. Salvation is just a term that means to be made whole. and accept Jesus Christ into your heart. How do you do it? The Bible says, if you confess with your mouth, believe in your heart that God has raised Jesus from the dead, you shall be saved. Number one, salvation. Number two, restoration, reconciliation. Some of you might have just drifted away from God. You've been in the pandemic, you've been worried, you've been staying at home, but now you're saying, God, I need you. But Lord, help me get back to renewing my faith in you. And that's restoration. God is a God of restoration. He's a God of reconciliation. That's what he gave to that prodigal son, showed us through a loving father, which is about his father, that we can come back to him at any time. No matter where we've been, no matter what we've done, God will restore. It's about reconciliation. Number three, first salvation, second reconciliation. Number three, church affiliation. Some of you need a church home. You need somebody praying with you and praying for you. You need a covering in your life. You don't need to be drifting here and there, being inconsistent, but God, I need to be at a place where I can serve you with my gifts that you have given me. If you fit any of those three, raise your hand. You can step down front, whatever it is. We just want to acknowledge and say thank you for God blessing you today. Is there one? I see a hand. We just need someone. Someone's on the way. Is there another hand? Someone who needs salvation, restoration, church affiliation. We're here for you. We love you. You can't find, we know no church is perfect. Stop looking for the perfect church, because the minute you show up, it's not perfect anymore. The minute we show up, it's not being perfect. Just follow the Spirit of the Lord and be faith, have faith. So any of those, as you're praying, God bless you, Minister Gwen. Is there another one that wants to come before we go? God bless you. Father, we thank you for the one. We thank you for just allowing your Spirit to speak to her. And we pray that as Minister Gwen is ministering to her, God, that you would just speak through. God, that you would deliver, that you would do something that only you can get the credit for. We give you thanks and praise for all that you do. In the name of Jesus, and for others who might need salvation, but for some reason they're just anxious today, they're unsure. God, I pray that you break down the unsure barrier. Father, I pray for those who need reconciliation. I pray that they stop running and stop oscillating, but they would come back to you. And Father, we pray for those who need a church home. I pray, oh God, that you would open up their hearts and let them know, direct and order the steps of the righteous. In the name of Jesus, we pray. And everybody says amen and amen.